This morning, as we come to the communion table, I'm going to take you to a passage of scripture I don't think you would ever really come to, or maybe this is the first time you've come to it, but open up your scripture with me to Numbers chapter 15. Numbers chapter 15, I want to give you a little bit of history, a little bit of background on where some of these ideas came from. Here in this section of scripture, the people are still wandering around in the wilderness, and they're moving towards the land of Canaan. They're moving towards the promised land. And if you're there with me, follow along as I read the first 10 verses, okay? Beginning in verse 1, it says, "Now the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, Speak to the sons of Israel and say to them, When you enter the land where you are to live, which I am giving you, then make an offering by fire to the Lord, a burnt offering or a sacrifice to fulfill a special vow, or as a freewill offering, or in your appointed times to make a soothing aroma to the Lord, from the herd or from the flock. The one who presents his offering shall present to the Lord a grain offering of 1/10 of an ephah of fine flour, mixed with 1/4 of a hin of oil. And you shall prepare wine for the drink offering, 1/4 of a hin, with a burnt offering and for the sacrifice for each lamb. Or for a ram you shall prepare as a grain offering 2/10 of an ephah of fine flour mixed with 1/3 of a hin of oil. And for the drink offering you shall offer 1/3 of a hin of wine as a soothing aroma to the Lord. When you prepare a bull as a burnt offering or a sacrifice to fulfill a special vow or for peace offerings to the Lord, then you shall offer with a bull a grain offering of 3/10 of an ephah of fine flour mixed with 1/2 of a hin of oil. And you shall offer as the drink offering 1/2 a hin of wine as offering by fire as soothing aroma to the Lord." What I want you to pay attention to this morning is verse 2. Look at that again with me. Verse 2. Because I think it's very interesting here, talking about these people moving into the promised land someday. They're not there yet. We see in verse 2, "Speak to the sons of Israel and say to them, when?" When? Like, not now. When you enter the land where you are to live, which I am giving you. Then, verse 3, "Then make an offering by fire to the Lord, a burnt offering or a sacrifice to fulfill a special vow or as a freewill offering or in your appointed times to make a soothing aroma to the Lord from the herd or from the flock." Now, as we think about this section of scripture, we need to understand that taking part of any communion service is sacred unto the Lord. Like any other offering, this offering is God ordained. God directed it as his form of worship that he enjoys. And so even when we come to this table this morning, it is not for the unbelieving world. It is only for those who by faith have entered, quote unquote, the promised land. Okay? So when we think about when or then, I'd like for you to think about your own salvation story this morning. If by chance you know of a time when you entered into your rest, then I would encourage you to take part in the communion service, because then you will be obeying the Lord and what he has required from your life, that you will take part in this communion service. Again, in the offering here of Numbers 15, I think it's very interesting that this specific offering that they were to make when they entered into their place of rest all included bread, it included wine, and it included the lamb. Bread, wine, and the lamb, which again is the picture of what you are going to be presented with at the communion table. We see these same elements in the New Testament when the Lord instituted what we formally call the Lord's Supper. Again, I want to take you to a different scripture, Matthew chapter 26. We're often not here when we talk about communion, but I think it's important that you understand that this also is in scripture. Matthew chapter 26, and actually verse 26, it says, "While they were eating, Jesus took some bread, and after a blessing, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, Take, eat, this is my body. And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is being poured out for many for forgiveness of sins. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now until the day when I drink it with you new in my Father's kingdom. Again, it is no small significance that Christ chooses here the emblems associated, even with Numbers chapter 15, of both bread and wine, because he is the great lamb that's going to be slain for the forgiveness of sins. Obviously, we know that the blood of Christ covers the forgiveness of sins, and here again in the scripture, when they did that offering of the land, they were to pour over this offering, the wine, to make it a holy representation of the blood that was sacrificed for their sins. Of course, Christ's blood covers all of our sins, and it's very symbolic of that original offering back in Numbers chapter 15. I think it's also symbolic, as I've already said, that as the people were entering into the land of Canaan, that they were required to have an offering associated with their permanent rest. Remember the word when and then from Numbers chapter 15. When you have stopped trying, in other words, to make your own way through the wilderness of life, so to speak, for the last 40 years, when you finally have come to the point, will you, by faith, will let me rescue you, save you, be your deliverer? When you finally come to that place, let's call it Jericho even, when by faith you're going to do what I ask you to do, when you finally come to that place of salvation and all of your problems are thrown onto the Lord and you by faith accept and believe in God to be your salvation, then you will find your rest. You will find your place in Christ. How? By faith in the cross of Christ for the forgiveness of our sins. We are given peace with God and fellowship with him forevermore. The bread and the wine are just symbolic, if you will, of the blessings of God. They represent your place of rest. If you have accepted Christ as your Lord, then you may partake of communion, as I said this morning, because the work of your salvation has been laid to rest on the cross and on the empty tomb of Jesus. Obviously, in the New Testament, we know that the body of Christ is associated with the bread, that it was broken for us, and the blood was his blood poured out for us for the remission of sins. And like every sacrifice or offering, your participation of these elements on the Lord's table comes with a correct heart attitude to worship him in purity. And for that, let me remind you of by going now to our original text in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, the one that we always read to you on this special communion Sunday, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and let's again be reminded of our heart attitude that's required in order to take the Lord's Supper. 1 Corinthians 11, beginning in verse 23, it says, "For I received from the Lord that which I delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But a man must examine himself, and in so doing he is to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks judgment to himself if he does not judge the body rightly. For this reason, many among you are weak and sick, and a number sleep. But if we judged ourselves rightly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are disciplined by the Lord, so that we will not be condemned along with the world. So then, my brethren, whenever you come together to eat, wait for one another. If anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, so that you will not come together for judgment. And the remaining matters I will arrange when I come." I'd like for you also to turn to Psalms chapter 51. Psalms chapter 51. And when you find your place in Psalms 51, I'm asking you to bow your head this morning. And with a head bowed, read along in this scripture with me. Psalms chapter 51. With every head bowed, let me just say this. On the heels of the last sermons that I have delivered over the past few weeks on both humility and sin. This morning I am asking you to take Psalms 51 very seriously as you take extra time for reflection and prayer. Family, perhaps the longest prayer of your day is the one around the dinner table. I'm asking you perhaps to pray a little bit longer today, that now is the time to pray a long prayer. And family, as we read Psalms 51, my encouragement to you is not to rush in or rush through what you need to say to God today. I would encourage you to repent of your sin, to name it, to leave it there, walk away from it, and walk in step with your God. So with every head bowed, I will read Psalms 51 to you. Psalms 51, if you're reminded, this is a contrite sinner's prayer for pardon. It was a psalm written by David after the prophet Nathan did his job by speaking truth into his life, calling out the sin that he had in his life that he committed against Uriah, the husband of Bathsheba. Beginning in verse 1 says, "Be gracious to me, O God, according to your loving kindness. According to the greatness of your compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified when you speak and blameless when you judge. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Behold, you desire truth in the innermost being, and in the hidden part you will make me know wisdom. Purify me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness. Let the bones which you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will be converted to you. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, the God of my salvation. Then my tongue will joyfully sing of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips that my mouth may declare your praise. For you do not delight in sacrifice, otherwise I would give it. You are not pleased with burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a broken and a contrite heart. O God, you will not despise." Let's take a few minutes to pray, okay? With a head bowed. Let's take a few minutes to pray and prepare our hearts for the communion service this morning. Jeremy, will you come and pass out the plate with me? Let's do this together, family, shall we? As we open up the bread side of the cup, I'll ask Jeremy to say a quick prayer for us to remind us of Christ's broken body and to pray for the bread. As you open up the cup, let me pray for that real quick before we take it, okay? Father in heaven, we again thank you for this cup. Lord, in our hands is a representation of the blood that was drained from your body. Lord, we know from Old Testament scripture that that blood is needed to pay for our sins. And Lord, our sins have cost Christ his life, cost Christ his blood. Thank you for this cup, that we may drink of it, that we may have your forgiveness, that we may move forward in holiness and right standing with you as long as we truly do repent of our sins. Lord, I cannot thank you enough for this great gift, and I pray specifically for all of us that we would honor this gift every day of our life moving from this point forward. Pray for all these things in Christ's name. Go ahead and take the cup. Thank you. All right. Again, if you have your section of scripture, let's turn to 1 Corinthians. It's hard to believe that since November, we have been in 1 Corinthians, and yet here we are in chapter 6. There's a lot of weeks that we continue to pore over this section of scripture, and as you know, when you study the Word of God, there is just so much that you can learn from each page. My goal is to finish the year having finished 1 Corinthians. That's my goal. And so this morning we're going to be in 1 Corinthians 6, covering the first half of the chapter, and hopefully next week or the week when I come back, I will cover the back half of 1 Corinthians chapter 6, and we'll continue to cruise right along. This morning I have put up again our vision statement of 3 John 4, that I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. And men and ladies, I pray that you find truth in your soul. I pray that you find truth from Scripture that affects your soul, so much so that you can't help falling on your knees or falling on your elbows and rubbing your face in the carpet, just trying to be absolutely humble before God. And out of that humility, family, comes transformation. Out of that humility comes growth in the church. Out of humility comes a passion for evangelism, and I hope that you bring that passion with you next week into the church, because Elder Wayne Rowland's going to be speaking to you about evangelism, and I hope that's a blessing to you. And I hope from a pure heart before the Lord that that'll be transformative for the church, that we'll become out of that service more empowered to share the gospel with everybody who needs to hear it. After all, it has affected our life in such a profound way. Well, if you have your sermon notebook, you can also open it. Today's topic in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 will be about lawsuits. That is the generic topic, lawsuits. Today, if you want to date your notebook, it's August 7th, 2022. And the word that I want to focus on this morning primarily is the word defraud. Defraud. I'm going to give to you right out of the bat the definition so that you have time to think about it. If we were to define defraud, it would be this way. This is literally copied and pasted right out of the Strong's Concordance. It says, to be behindhand, come too late as to be far from, or to fail a person or thing. It's used of persons not present at the right time, to fail to make use of a good day, or to let the opportunity pass by. And as I was contemplating that sentence, I was thinking of all of the ways that we can let opportunities pass by in our lives that thereby defraud each other of things that are important to each other and needed in each other's lives. For example, do we come too late to offer our services? Do we fail each other by not being there for each other? Are we behindhand? Other hands are doing things, we are far from those hands that are doing things. Now, I know that we're talking about lawsuits and lawsuits in the church, and perhaps you're already thinking in your head, well, I've never taken anybody to court before, so this passage of scripture, I might as well be able to skip right over and not think too long about. But I would say, family, that there has probably been at least one time in your life that regardless of whether you took somebody to court or not, you have probably been the arbiter, the umpire, the judge, and so defrauded your neighbor in some way. How do I know that? Well, because we're all sinners. And scripture is clear that often we commit the sin of omission and we do not do the things that we should do to our shame. As we get started, I actually want to start where the plane's going to end. If you want to go with me to Romans chapter 12, many times in a conversation or an argument or a sermon, we build up steam, we take off, we fly around for a little while, then we land the plane on some kind of significant point. Today, I just want to give you that significant point as we begin. And I think it's found in Romans chapter 12. I don't think that there's a better place to go that talks about how we can defraud one another of the love that we should be giving to one another. In my Bible, the chapter has a heading that says dedicated service, and here the Apostle Paul, speaking to this group of believers in Rome, are talking about that specific thing. How can we serve each other in love? Beginning in verse 1, it says, therefore I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. For through the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think more highly of himself than he ought to think, but to think so as to have sound judgment. There is again a tone of being an arbiter, to have sound judgment. not thinking too highly of yourself, but using sound judgment, as God has allotted to each a measure of faith. Verse 4, for just as we have many members in one body, and all the members do not have the same function, so we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another. Since we have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, each of us is to exercise them accordingly. If prophecy, and if I can just qualify that for a minute, we know that we don't have new scripture being revealed to us today, but I do believe that the spiritual gift of prophecy is, as we read about with Nathan, who spoke truth into David's life and convicting him of sin, I do believe that the gift of prophecy can be very exhorting one another about sin that is living in our lives that needs to be dealt with. So I'll qualify it that way. For us to exercise them accordingly, if prophecy, according to the proportion of his faith, if service in his serving, or he who teaches in his teaching, or he who exhorts in his exhortation, he who gives with liberality, he who leads with diligence, he who shows mercy with cheerfulness. Let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor. Here it is, verse 11, not lagging behind in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, persevering in tribulation, devoted to prayer, contributing to the needs of the saints, practicing hospitality, blessing those who persecute you, bless and do not curse, rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. Be of the same mind toward one another. Do not be haughty in mind, but associate with the lowly. Do not be wise in your own estimation. Never pay back evil for evil to anyone. Respect what is right in the sight of all men. If possible, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. Never take your own revenge, beloved, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. But if your enemy is hungry, feed him. And if he is thirsty, give him drink. For in so doing, you will keep burning coals on his head. And do not be overcome by evil, but be overcome evil with good. Now, there's a lot of things in there that are going to match really close to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. I would like to just remind you of two verses, verse 10 and 11, where it says, be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference. Give preference. So this morning, we were having a discussion about Oreos this morning. Could we give preference to somebody else for what Oreo we will eat for the rest of our lives? Maybe. But there are obviously bigger issues in the church than that. How do we give preference to one another in honor? In verse 11, not lagging behind in diligence. Not lagging behind. And here it is that word defraud, to be behindhand, come too late, to fail a person or a thing. Use the persons not present at the right time to fail to make use of a good day to let the opportunity pass by. Paul is encouraging us to not lag behind. So my sermon title this morning is Lawsuits Discouraged. And my hope this morning is to answer the question, why? I'll give you some reasons why I think lawsuits should be discouraged from Scripture. Obviously, we're going to be in the New Testament. We're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, so if you would like, you can turn back there with me as I read it. Obviously, this is the first time that we've been in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, and so I do want to take the time to read this section of Scripture to you as well. Beginning in verse 1, under a heading in my Bible that says, Lawsuits Discouraged, we see in verse 1, does any one of you, when he has a case against his neighbor, dare to go to the law before the unrighteous and not before the saints? Or do you not know that the saints will judge the world? If the world is judged by you, are you not competent to constitute the smallest law courts? Do you not know that we will judge angels? How much more matters of this life? So if you have law courts dealing with matters of this life, do you appoint them as judges who are no account to the church? I say this to your shame. It is so. Is it so that there is not among you one wise man who will be able to decide between his brethren? But brother goes to law with brother, and that before unbelievers. Actually, then, it is already a defeat for you that you have lawsuits with one another. Why not rather be wronged? Why not rather be defrauded? On the contrary, you yourselves wrong and defraud. You do this even to your own brethren. You do not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor homosexuals, nor thieves, nor the covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Such were some of you. But you were washed. But you were sanctified. But you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and in the Spirit of our God. And to that point, I'm going to stop right there. Let's pray. Father, what we know not, teach us, and what we have not, give us, and what we are not, Lord, make us. Pray for all these things in Christ's name. Amen. As we get going, I want to do a brief recap of the odd chapters in 1 Corinthians. Beginning in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, I'd just like to highlight a couple things. In chapter 1, we see the context of who we are talking about. Obviously, this is the church in Corinth. Here in this context, we actually do have believers. These are Christians who are empowered, like we are empowered by the Holy Spirit. And yet, sadly, this church is not utilizing the Holy Spirit. However, we do see that the Holy Spirit is in their lives. If you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning in verse 4, it says, I thank my God always concerning you for the grace of God which was given you in Christ Jesus, that in everything you were enriched in him, in all speech and all knowledge. Even as the testimony concerning Christ was confirmed in you, so that you are not lacking in any gift, awaiting eagerly the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will also confirm or sustain you to the end, blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Family, these people, as hard as we have been on them, so to speak, or as hard as Scripture has been on them, so to speak, how hard as Paul has been on them, so to speak, they have the Holy Spirit. Why they are living the way that they're living is the fact that they just aren't tapping in to the Holy Spirit. They are living in sin. As a result, we see a negative discord among the church. If you look at verse 10 of the same chapter, now I exhort you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all agree. There would be some preference that there be no divisions among you, but that you be made complete in the same mind and the same judgment. For I have been informed concerning you, my brethren, by Chloe's people, that there are quarrels among you. Absolutely not good. I think it's important for us to understand some of the repeated phrases in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, because I think it only highlights or further highlights the lack of Holy Spirit engagement that these people had. If you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 6, this phrase, or do you not know, happens six times in this chapter alone. We see it here in chapter 6 and verse 2, or do you not know that the saints will judge the world? We see it again in verse 3, do you not know that we will judge angels? We see it in verse 9, or do you not know that the unrighteous will inherit the kingdom of God? We see it again in verse 15. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Verse 16. Do you not know that the one who joins himself to a prostitute is one in body with her? And again in verse 19. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you? Again, if these people were living and abiding by the Holy Spirit, there's a lot of things that they would know. Unfortunately, they are not walking in tune, walking in step with the Holy Spirit. Otherwise, that they would be taught by the Holy Spirit. I mean, if you look at John chapter 14 and verse 16, it writes, I will ask the Father and he will give you another helper, that he will be with you forever. That is the Spirit of truth whom the world cannot receive because it does not see him or know him, but you know him because he abides with you and will be in you. This helper, this teacher will teach you the word of God and instruct you in the way that you need to go. If we move on then to chapter 3, speaking of another odd chapter, chapter 3, Paul here is mentioning to the church that they are acting as mere men. Look at verse 1. It says, "And I, brethren, could not speak to you as to spiritual men, but as to men of flesh, as to infants in Christ. I gave you milk to drink, not solid food, for you were not yet able to receive it." Why? Because they were brand new Christians. However, Scripture says, "Indeed, even now you are not able," which is the shame, "for you are still fleshly." They're still living in their sin. "For since there is jealousy and strife among you, are you not fleshly and are you not walking like mere men?" And here again is the problem with this church. They're not walking empowered by the Holy Spirit. They are living with sin that is undealt with in their life, and it is destroying the church. The contrast between them and Paul is that Paul is a master builder. If you look at chapter 3 and verse 10, it says, "According to the grace of God which was given to me," that is Paul, "like a wise master builder, I laid a foundation, and another is building on it. But each man must be careful how he builds on it." Because Paul is a master builder, then he is walking into this church and inspecting this church, kind of like a building inspector, and he is mentioning a couple of the things right off the bat that are absolutely wrong about this building. Obviously, he wants it to succeed. He wants it to succeed, and therefore he wants to speak truth into their lives. But he also reminds them that they are responsible for their own works. Eventually, they will stand and they will give an account. And so we read that in verses 10 through 15. "According to the grace of God, which was given to me, like a wise master builder, I laid a foundation, and another is building on it. But each man must be careful how he builds on it." In other words, you need to use some discernment there, how to build on it. "For no man can lay a foundation other than the one which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if any man builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, or straw, each man's work will become evident, for the day will show it, because it is to be revealed with fire, and that fire itself will test the quality of each man's work. If any man's work which he has built on it remains, he will receive a reward. If any man's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet as through fire." It just kind of gives you that idea again of not defrauding your loved one in Christ, being diligent, being there, doing the job that you are called to do, to not waste the day, to move forward so that you can present fruit to God someday, gifts and rewards that you can throw back at the feet of Christ. Chapter 5, then, Paul moves from some general principles of building correctly to some of the very specific issues of their builder. And again, like a building inspector, he has taken the time to show them some of the major faults that need to be addressed immediately. Here we see in this chapter a case where a man's sexual immorality must be addressed. I mean, there is a shame on this church for having sin that is not even spoken among the Gentiles or the unbelievers. We read that in chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. It says, "It's actually reported that there is immorality among you, and immorality of such a kind that does not even exist among the Gentiles, that someone has his father's wife. You've become arrogant, have not mourned instead, so that the one who had done this deed would be removed from your midst." This is a case where the church body has the facts of the case. However, they're not executing their responsibility to live a holy and righteous life and to keep the church holy. Rather, they have chosen to keep associating with his brother who is continually living in sin. It's one of those things where this little sin, if you want to call it that, can grow into a major sin in the church. It's, if you think about it in the course of a building or a building project, if, let's say, you're building a project using concrete and you don't mix the concrete correctly, the entire building will fail, okay? Here it is with this church. I mean, they're allowing concrete to build the church that is inferior. It will not hold the test of time. They should have started with a product that is really sincere and really truthful about what it is, and therefore have that way it would not affect the whole of the church. Well, we get into chapter 6 then with that kind of rewind there with another major fault in this building that this master builder is pointing out. This is a case where many believers, rather than the one that is in chapter 5, there's many believers here who have shamed the church by not being able to handle their worldly affairs amongst themselves. Namely, that you have multiple members of the church taking each other to court to resolve their personal matters. This morning, as I said earlier, I want to just offer you a few reasons why lawsuits among believers is discouraged, dare I say, shameful. Number one, as a spiritual insight and as a proven historical truth, taking each other to court is shameful because God's wisdom begins with God and fearing Him. I know you know the verse, but you can flip there if you want. Go to Proverbs chapter 9 and verse 10. Most of you probably have this memorized, which says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding." So, does the unbelieving world fear God? And if they don't fear God, then what is their foundation? I mean, it can't be in wisdom and it can't be understanding, because wisdom and understanding come out of the Lord. And therefore, when we take lawsuits to the unbelieving world, do we expect them to act in wise and wonderful ways? No. I mean, their lives speak for themselves, and we can look at all of history, both in the past and in the future, to know how unbelievers act in very unwise ways. Flip with me to Romans chapter 1 and look at verse 21. Here is a description of people who abandoned the truth about God. Romans 1:21 says, "Even though they knew God, they did not honor Him as God or give thanks, but they became futile in their speculations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools, and they exchanged the glory of the incorruptible God for an image in the form of corruptible man and of birds and four-footed animals and crawling creatures. Therefore, God gave them over in their lusts of their hearts to impurity, so that their bodies would be dishonored among them, for they exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason, God gave them over to degrading passions, for their women exchanged the natural function for that which is unnatural. And in the same way, also the men abandoned the natural function of the woman and burned in their desire toward one another, committing indecent acts with each other and receiving in their own persons the due penalty of their error." And here, family, is just the natural decline of the human race without God. They will continue to make shameful, shameful errors, thinking that they are wise in their speculations, but they are absolutely foolish. So why, family, as a church, would we take a lawsuit between each other to an unbelieving, darkened soul? It doesn't make any sense. Secondly, reason why lawsuits among believers is discouraged is taking each other to court is shameful because the ungodly should never be given authority by the church members to judge or at the very least umpire the godly. I mean, I've given you so many scriptures here at the bottom of this slide to say it 1,000 different ways, and just think we need to look at a few of these. I mean, look at the context of all of Scripture here. Over and over and over again, it talks about how the righteous will judge the unrighteous. Daniel 7, verse 21 through 22, it says, "I kept looking, and that horn was waging war with the saints and overpowering them until the Ancient of Days came, and judgment was passed in favor of the saints and of the highest one, and at the time arrived when the saints took possession of the kingdom." Now, if you have saints who take possession of the kingdom, Who do you think is making the decisions in that kingdom? The saints, the godly people. They're the ones who are making sure that proper judgment is taking place inside that kingdom. If you go to Matthew chapter 19 and verse 28, Christ here himself talks about it this way. Matthew 19, 28, and Jesus said to them, "Truly I say to you, that you who have followed me in the generation when the Son of Man will sit on his glorious throne, you also shall sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel." Here again we have followers of Christ, disciples, the apostles, ruling, reigning, judging on 12 thrones. If you go even further in your New Testament to the book of Jude, Jude chapter 1, all the way near the end of the Bible, Jude chapter 1. Verses 14 and 15, we read, "And it was about these men that Enoch in the seventh generation from Adam," think about that, "seventh generation from Adam, it was prophesied by Enoch, saying, 'Behold, the Lord came with many thousands of his holy ones to execute judgment upon all and to convict all the ungodly of their ungodly deeds, which they have done in an ungodly way, and all the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against him.'" Hear it again, you see it. Same thing with Revelation chapter 2 and verse 26 and 27. You see this. Christ says, "He who overcomes and he who keeps my deeds until the end, to him I will give authority over the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of the potter are broken to pieces, as also I have received authority from my Father, and I will give him the morning star. And he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." That be all the churches. Revelation chapter 20, go there with me, we'll look quick, we'll finish it off. Revelation chapter 20 and verse 4, it says, "Then I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was given to them. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of their testimony of Jesus and because of the word of God, and those who had not worshipped the beast or his image and had not received the mark on their forehead and on their hand, and they came to life and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. Reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. The rest of the dead did not come to life until 1,000 years were completed. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is the one who has a part in the first resurrection. Over these, the second death has no power, but they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. So obviously when you're reigning, you're making a lot of judgment calls. As a righteous person, as a person who has accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, you will be part of that reigning system. I really believe in a literal kingdom where we're going to have roles, and I really do believe that you will have power to make decisions that best benefit the kingdom of God. We could say that that is true even for today. Third goal, reasons why lawsuits among believers is discouraged. Taking another Christian to court is the kind of shame where a believer is so unbelievably declaring to the rest of the world how incredibly unforgiving and selfish, just like the unbelieving world, they are. Now that's quite a statement, isn't it? Well, what defines a person going to hell? Well, in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 9 through 11, we see it listed there. But what was defining the church members in Corinth? Well, we see in verse 8, it says, "You yourselves wrong and defraud. You do this even to your brethren." It is absolutely shameful that we should look like the unbelieving world. And if that is how we live our life, if that is what we like to do, to defraud one another of the work or of the love or of the gifts that are clearly due to one another in love by Scripture, we're really just declaring to the world and to even our own brothers in Christ just how either sinful or how untransformed we are under the power of the Holy Spirit. And dare I say, whether you're saved at all. maybe that should be taken under consideration. So what then should Christians do? Well, 1 Corinthians 6 says, let it go. Be wronged, be defrauded for the sake of unity in the church. I mean, that's how Paul says it. Isn't it better to be wronged, verse 7, rather not be defrauded? You might be just saying to me this morning, Pastor, you're off your rocker. Like, no one will accept being defrauded of anything. Well, to that point, I'll give you Matthew chapter 5 from the Great Sermon on the Mount, where your Lord and Savior talks about how you should deal with other people. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 39, Christ says, but I say to you, do not resist an evil person, but whoever slaps you on the right cheek, turn the other to him also. And if anyone wants to sue you, oh, that's interesting. If anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, let him have your coat also. Whoever forces you to go 1 mile, go with him two. Go with him two. Again, I highlight this word defraud to you. Defraud means to be behindhand, come too late, as to be far from or to fail a person or a thing. Use the person's not present at the right time to fail or to make use of a good day and to let an opportunity pass by. And again, I challenge all of us with the same questions I did earlier as we close up. Do we let opportunities pass by and therefore defraud each other? Do we come too late to offer our services? Do we fail each other? I mean, Romans 12 and verse 9 through 11, I think, says it clearer than anywhere else, that love must be free of hypocrisy, that yes, we need to detest what is evil, we need to cling to what is good, we need to be devoted to one another in brotherly love, we give preference to one another in honor. Verse 11, not lagging behind in diligence, fervent in spirit, and serving the Lord. And perhaps the good example that we're all familiar with is the Good Samaritan. The godly man walked right by that person in the ditch. Couldn't be bothered. Defrauded him. Defrauded him. Came too late, right? Then another person got the reward of doing a good job and has been remembered in all of history. Fourthly, reasons why lawsuits among believers is discouraged, that God's just wrath is executed on untransformed men and women who don't display godliness. And obviously, we see this in 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 7, where it says, it's already a defeat for you that you have lawsuits with one another. You're already defeated. And I think that we need to take that very, very seriously, whether or not we are a defeated Christian, whether or not the devil has won over our life. And let me give you just one more that is much more terrifying. In Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 through 35, we read this. Matthew chapter 18, verse 21, it says, then Peter came and said to him, Lord, how often shall I forgive my brother who sins against me? Up to 7 times? And Jesus said to him, I do not say to you up to 7 times, but up to 70 times 7. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he had begun to settle them, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. But since he did not have the means to repay, his Lord commanded him to be sold along with his wife and children and all that he had in repayment to be made. So the slave fell on the ground, prostrated himself before him, saying, have patience with me and I will repay you everything. And here is the Lord we serve. And the Lord of that slave felt compassion and released him and forgave him the debt. First word of verse 28, but the slave went out and found one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And he seized him and began to choke him, saying, pay back what you owe. So his fellow slave fell to the ground and pleaded with him, same way, have patience with me and I will repay you. But this man who was forgiven so much was unwilling and went and threw him in prison until he should pay back what was owed. So when his fellow slaves saw that what had happened, they were deeply grieved and came and reported to their lord all that had happened. Good job. Verse 32, then summoning him, his lord said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all your debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not also have had mercy on your fellow slave in the same way that I had mercy on you? And his lord, moved with anger, handed him over to the torturers until he should repay all that was owed him. My heavenly Father will also do the same to you if each of you does not forgive his brother from the heart. Tell me that's not terrifying. Terrifying. Well, family, all I can say to you this morning is, as your pastor over the last 5 or 6 years, over and over and over and over and over again, I have seen your goodness to each other and how good you've been to me specifically. My wife and I can give you 100 testimonies of how this church has not defrauded their pastor of what was good, but gave him everything he needed. And to that point, I commend you. I thank you for your love and for your faithfulness, for your respect, for your kindness, for the way you treat me, the way that you have given me authority, even in your own life, to speak scripture to you. I just pray from the bottom of my heart that God blesses you for that. Sometimes, family, however, it's easier to treat maybe a pastor who seemingly lives a fairly moral life. It's a whole lot harder to treat somebody who's in your life who isn't moral at all. But that's the command, family, to not defraud that person, not to fall behind, not to waste a good day, but that you would love that person who doesn't love you back. Now that's more like Christ. Father in heaven, I thank you so much for today and for your word, and I thank you for all of the people who have gathered this morning. Lord, we don't want to take lawsuits out and sue each other. I don't think anybody in this church does, but Lord, this word defraud sat heavy with me this week, and may it never be said of us that we would defraud each other of love and goodness and kindness that's expected of us. It's not due, it's expected. Lord, may you find us to be willing partners with you in the love of humanity. May we crucify ourselves to the cross. May we live for you and not for ourselves. May we not be like the Corinthians who were selfish in some way. Maybe it was for greed. Maybe they were swindling people out of money. Maybe that was just their sin that was normal that they were having a hard time breaking from. But Lord, may that not be said of us. May we be honest and true and faithful and loving. And may this work go forward, because your people here really want to see it move forward. They really want to not waste the day, but do it with all their might for your honor and for your glory. Pray for all these things in Christ's name. Amen.